section 26 on page 37. And it says in that some key corporate functions need to be better attuned to supporting the implementation of service delivery changes, including HR/OD, which needs to develop a clear workforce strategy that reflects the intended direction of travel with the future operating model. So again, I'd like to understand what that's about. You could read it to suggest that there's some perhaps resistance or somebody's not up to speed in making a change, but I'd like to hear what it's about.
Term planning is now taking place. We now have the 20 budgets, we now have the vision for Thank you, Chair. I thought generally the report showed that the council was making a good way of travel, but I just wanted to refer to number 37. However, the council's key corporate services are not consistently focused on helping to deliver new models of working. Services like transactional human resources, organisational development, asset management, legal and property are too often ponderous, risk-averse rather than risk-aware, not sufficiently enabling or quick enough to respond to as change moves at pace. I just wondered, seeing it was November that this was came out, what have we done to address that implied criticism?
Yes, I'd like to echo what Walter just said. I'd like us to be less risk averse and go for it. But my point is, I've been away, so I've read this quickly, and to me it seemed like a very positive report. And let's not forget, we invited this review. And the reason we invited it was to pick up points that the review had picked up. So we're not just looking internally, and we're not just navel gazing. But the thing that comes across with me is, and it shows the leadership have got the confidence to invite the peer review on right hand. But on page 23, section number 9, it highlights there the challenge that this council has got in the salary cut. And it also says that we're suffering larger cuts than other authorities similar to ourselves. Now I do think, and I feel, and having read this, gives me more confidence. I think we've got a leadership in place now, and it's a stable leadership, and that, let's not forget, is up to the people of the Wirral to decide who the leadership is in this council. And we're putting the blocks in place now to carry this council forward, despite the cost that we're suffering. And that's all I'd like to say to you. So well done to the leadership and to the senior officer.
Thank you, Chair. Something more practical now. Just wondering the action plan. I just wondering on the actual action points. On the action points, have they actually gone back to the peer review? Is that just internal that that's come up with? And obviously we've got, as what you mentioned, how we're going to monitor this. Everything's green at the moment, which is great, because no deadlines have been reached yet. This is
2012, and some of the issues that they highlighted as significant problems and real risk areas, and you recall they actually did put a significant challenge in front of us in terms of how we respond to an organisation. We know that in March of last year we did receive the LGC award for the most improved council. So it's the most improved, it wasn't the best council, and I think what this does is still say that we've still got things that we need to sort out. But I actually also think, and I think it's important to go back to 2012 bit, because if we were in such a difficult space then in terms of where the peer review team was seeing us, in some ways it's not surprising we were a bit more risk averse, because it was about getting some of our building blocks in place in a very sure footing. I think what's being pointed out to us now is that we actually need to be a bit more fleet of foot, a bit more sure footed about what we do, so that we can be slipping. That's about terms of the specific action points, the peer review team are fully satisfied with the action plan. That they are aware of that, and we keep them updated in terms of progress. They will be coming back, I think it's in June, to review, to make sure that we had said what we would do. And in terms of that specific point, which was, so I think my steps on page 33, wasn't it? Yes, in terms of the role of the board members. Not an action point that's been put down here, because that's built into one of the pledges, and I think Councillor Davis, Councillor George Davis, has actually held a seminar to try and encourage and build on how we go through neighbourhood engagement, the use of constituency committees, etc. And that we saw that as part of that role.
Can I just clarify? Obviously, from a scrutiny perspective, we want to be monitoring the implementation of how effective it is. Am I correct in thinking that it would rightly sit in transformation?
I think in some ways it's a natural fit for transformation resources, but this is actually called council. And I think it's important that as a consequence of it, perhaps this committee needs to be.
Okay, go up to Janette and then Ron. And then the
same. Thank you, Chair. My fault of a comment here with obviously I'll be to what Mike said well and other party and all of it. I think that the council has undergone such just drastic and rapid change brought about since it hit us that I absolutely want to applaud everyone who's helped put where we are. Yes, there's been improvement showing the good improvement at our reward. And I'd just like to make a special note on paragraph 14, where it acknowledges that we're a member of the authority, members and officers were not together, and I think that's really what everyone can do, because we do. And it's crucial that we do. We don't want to go back to the bad old days. I only hear about it over here, where members and officers perhaps even have the most cordial relations. So I think it's a pass on the back.
Ron?
Yeah. Yeah.
I'll ask you to move on now, because we've got a lot of questions.
Janette has said, but also to try to bring people back to page 25 through to page 26. And it's the intensive issue around the partnership and making sure partners step up to the plate, as opposed to being world council, being the sole driver, the coach. Should have multiple drivers as the coach. And there's some weaknesses in that area. And what steps are being taken to make sure that the partners do step up, and also make sure the partners who aren't signed up are signed on the sort of card of the report that I was about to see when we get strengthened.
Could you jump very much? And then Christina, I think we've done then. Wendy and yeah, I want to move on, but yes, okay. Christina and then Wendy and then briefly.
You might have answered this question, Mr. Drop, but I couldn't exactly hear everything you said down the sentence in the head. The first four items on page 1-3 of 31, which are the ones to be finished by March 16, which have a status of green, presumably, because this report was written a while ago. And then on the next page, 2-3, the intersection, well, clearly that one's been done, the one on the budget. So we've got the first four. Did I miss you saying that they've all been done?
Analogy, but Yeah, in terms of that, when we said that those that would be achieved by March 2016, they have been achieved. So I think, as I said, as just in terms of page 31, highlighted that we did identify the immediate resource because we've actually for a short term engaged with Capita. In terms of the workforce development capacity, Tony Williamson led on that and ensured that that's taken place. In terms of commercial approach, that's a partnership, as I said, dealing with local partnerships with, as I say, the joint LGA.
So
and,
I can confirm
that they have all been done.
Wendy, I just wanted to note that, much like when Will goes to school as governor, the peer review have been a critical friend, and they have made various comments about things that could be improved, whether it's scrutiny or transformation and things like that. And I do hope that we'll manage to take on board all that they've said.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. I just wanted to get a bit more flesh on accountability statements. This is on page 32. Being issued to responsible officers at the start of each financial year. Perhaps we have an idea of how many officers have that. Mm-hmm. I think the theory is that Officer X has a budget which they've got to live within, and I'm not sure what this sign, like I agree to be shot if I don't manage it. Cllr Abbey's vision of coach drivers may put me in mind of the Italian job, but I don't think I want to go
well,
I can do this in flesh for the accountability statements.
Okay.
actions, which we knew that we weren't going to hit the target. I'm pleased to say that there has been, as I briefly discussed last time, a slight drop in our sickness actions in quarter three from 12.06 down to 11.65. At this moment in time, that's still somewhere up on 9.75 targets, but of course, we've still got quarter four to come to our end, hopefully, we're going to buy a shirt. Further reduction in that, and the other ones, of course, performance appraisals, and in terms of latest data that we have, 78% of all staff have had a performance appraisal, and 90% of managers have had those, and 6 of the 7 directorates have actually hit the target, although we know the target was set for September.
We did have quite a long discussion about the performance indicator 5. On page 44, the struggle that maybe this legal user contract, or delivery on that contract, and on 4, we had quite a long discussion about our families and well-being. We haven't got anybody from Happier Health here, but if we've got a question to ask that hasn't been covered, we're happy to pass that over and get a reply. But is anybody want to ask a question on these, given that we did look at them about 2 weeks ago? And also the second capital monitoring, we looked at this but the capital monitoring report agenda item 5 is 57. Yeah. into a deferred payment agreement with the council.
So they use the subsidies as collateral.
Yeah. Okay. Are we done on that one? Yeah. Well, at the end, we've got no business tonight. Yeah.